First at 8 a.m, a top infectious disease expert says the Omicron strain may not be as dangerous as initially feared, following confirmation it was in Australia days earlier than first thought. Our team is standing by with the latest on the Omicron strain. Leading us first is today Sydney reporter Gabrielle Boyle in Chatswood. Gabby, New South Wales infection tally has grown to 8 now.
Yeah, 8 in New South Wales, 9 across Australia, Sylvia, and we are expecting that number to continue to rise over the next couple of days, given that we've had a number of infected people out and about in the community. The latest details on that, a child under the age of 12, unvaccinated, who returned to Australia from Doha on Tuesday the 23rd, meaning it's been exposed to the community even earlier than we initially anticipated. And this young person was out and about in lots of different locations in very built-up areas. Here in Chatswood, the first of which is the Mantra Service Departments, where I'm joining you from. This child also attended Vodafone, Centrelink, Medicare, the Priceline at the Interchange, and also Woolworths. The second case that has authorities worried, but not so much, is an individual, an adult, that returned from Singapore to Australia on the 28th and is now in hotel quarantine. So both flights in relation to those two people are being very carefully monitored. Everybody on board those flights is being told they need to get tested and self-isolate until they receive a negative result. Medical experts say we should be keeping calm but very well aware.
The fact that they've been around for longer, both in the Netherlands and probably Australia, means it may not be as bad as everybody's thinking. Because if it has been around for many weeks in many countries already, it obviously isn't galloping out of control. So we need to be a bit careful we don't overreact to this.
Yeah, so, Sylvia, anyone that was on one of those flights or has attended any of those locations during the relevant window really does need to go out and get tested as quickly as possible.
Gabby, thank you.
Let's bring in Nine's Oliver Haig, who's at a testing site in Adelaide this morning. Ollie, South Australia's COVID cluster has now grown by 18 cases. How concerned are authorities there?
Well, David, good morning. This is our first COVID cluster since our borders reopened, but the Premier says this was all expected. Now, this latest cluster took place at a school reunion on Saturday night in Norwood. It grew by 16 cases yesterday. A further 2 cases were recorded from interstate travellers, and there is now 210 people in quarantine. We know one of the positive cases is former Premier Jay Weatherill. That has resulted in the Governor and Opposition Leader going into quarantine. And this comes as our testing requirements for New South Wales travellers have been bolstered here in South Australia. Anyone coming from there does need to be tested on arrival amid concerns the Omicron variant could sneak into South Australia.
The problem is it's a two parts thing. I mean, on the one hand, you want to sort of close things up more, but the issue is that it may have already spread. It's already, the thing may have already got out of the
box. Now, as a result of this latest outbreak here in South Australia, WA has slammed its border shut to South Australia. Anyone wanting to travel there from SA does require a special exemption.
All right, Ollie, thanks for that.
The Victorian Ombudsman has told today they are satisfied with the new pandemic bill which has passed the upper house. Live to Today Melbourne reporter Isabella Stashkovsky. Isa, what was her reaction?
Tim, good morning. Well, there's been a lot of debate over this controversial pandemic legislation, a lot of criticism as well, including from our Ombudsman, Deborah Glass. But she now says she is satisfied after a number of significant amendments have been made. She says there's now more independent oversight and more scrutiny as well. One of those key changes is that the Chief Health Officer will no longer be able to make those pandemic orders when these new laws come into effect. That responsibility instead will go to a minister. Here's Deborah Glass speaking on Today on Nine.
There is much more accountability now in some very important respects. And I think the community can have a lot more confidence that there are checks on power that perhaps weren't there before.
Tim, nonetheless, this morning there are protesters in front of Government House. They've camped there overnight. They tell me they will be there for some time to come. They want to speak to the Governor about the pandemic legislation.
Isa, thank you.
Now to the flood crisis unfolding in Queensland. As some areas begin the task of mopping up, others are still bracing for rising floodwaters. Nine's Reece D'Alessandro is in Inglewood for us today. Reece, the flooding down there is now moving downstream.
Yeah, that's right, DC. Good morning to you. The flooding here at Inglewood is receding. The cleanup will continue here today. You can see the floodwaters behind us here, down at around 4.4 metres now compared to up around 11 at its peak. But the town to watch today is Gundawindi, 90 kilometres west of our location. The McIntyre River there is what the Bureau is keeping a very close eye on. It's at 10.12 metres at the moment. In 2011, it got to 10.64 metres. Tonight, it's expected to peak at 10.7 metres. At that height, the town's levees should keep the water out of the town itself. Any higher than that, we could see the evacuation of Gundawindi itself. We spoke to QFES Assistant Commissioner Stephen Smith on the Today Show on Nine a little earlier. He says the town is prepared. Take a listen.
Gundawindi is an incredibly prepared community for flood events like this. It's not unusual. They're used to them coming along. There's obviously a levee in place.
A 10.7 metre peak, DC, will be revised throughout the day as flood peaks further upstream are observed by the Bureau. Locals being advised to keep an eye out for the warnings.
Yes, fingers crossed for the residents there. Thanks for that, Reece. A Queensland police officer is being praised for his selfless efforts this morning, running into floodwaters to save the lives of four children, including a teenage girl found clinging to a tree in raging waters in Dalby. Constable Matt Owens joined us here on Today on Nine saying, well, he didn't think twice.
I didn't have any hesitation. Obviously, with myself and my partners, our main priority was the safety of the young boys and the young female. It was a little bit surprising, the strength of the current, I guess, with the floodwaters.
What a cool customer. Meantime, a clean-up operation is also underway in Melbourne this morning, where SES crews have been mopping up the aftermath of a severe storm, the second in as many days. There were the scenes in Croydon, south of Melbourne overnight, or in southern Melbourne, one of the worst affected suburbs. For more now, we're joined by Alistair Drayton from Victoria SES. Alistair, thank you very much for your time this morning. Which areas were hardest hit?
Yes, good morning, Sylvia. Well, the last 48 hours has seen a lot of activity right across Victoria. Wednesday saw impacts from sort of Geelong right the way through the Melbourne or the western suburbs of Melbourne, with Vic SES volunteers responding to about 350 calls, requests for assistance. And then yesterday, the last 24 hours, we've seen another 650 requests for assistance, predominantly in the eastern suburbs, but right the way through into Gippsland as well.
And how many calls have there been for help?
Well, in the last 48 hours, you know, around a total of about 1,000 jobs or requests for assistance from the community, of which I'm pleased to say that the Vic SES volunteers have now done about 950 of those, with about 50 of those will be cleared later on this morning.
Has the worst passed, do you think, for Melbourne now?
Well, I think it has, just for now, for the period, but as people would know, we've entered into a La Nina environment now, so we're going to be seeing some of these situations occur throughout summer, unfortunately for the traditional summer, but it is a sort of a high risk for any weather event going through into this particular year, and people should be cognizant of the conditions we have had in the last 24, 48 hours, as we will be seeing sort of some of those again throughout summer.
Yeah, it's been a wild couple of days in Melbourne. Alistair Drayton from Victoria SES, thanks very much.